Welcome to the sixth installment of the Four Winds on Wednesdays live stream. And I'm very excited about today's broadcast because we have three of my favorite members of your Los Angeles Symphonic Winds, and they're all woodwind players. And that's why we're calling this show a celebration of your Los Angeles woodwinds. The first of our guests is going to be Geoff Nudell, a clarinet player, colleague of mine, who also is a fantastic studio doubler, and we'll talk about that in just a moment. And then we'll be joined by Bob Crosby, who is going to have some interesting footage from an appearance he made in 1957 on the Dinah Shore television show. Some of you may have even seen it in its original broadcast. And then we'll finish up with our good friend Chuck Fernandez, as he directs the Song of Angels Flute Orchestra with a beautiful, beautiful arrangement of a piece called Tenderly, featuring a really terrific jazz guitar player. And we'll talk about him in just a little bit. But before I bring on these great musician colleagues of mine, I want to thank all of you for your continued support of this wonderful Four Winds on Wednesday series. We've had now over 500 views of this series on YouTube alone. So thank you for your continued support. And now let me, before we bring on my good friends and colleagues from the Los Angeles Symphonic Winds, play for you a piece that was written by somebody you're going to meet a little bit later on in the show. And that's a piece that Chuck Fernandez was commissioned to write for the wind ensemble at California State University, Northridge. And the idea was they were having a big tribute to one of the great band directors of all time and really a living legend, Sir David Whitwell, who was the director of bands at Cal State Northridge for a number of years and a great friend, I might add, of the Los Angeles Symphonic Winds. In fact, when they ran into trouble, of course, with the earthquake they had many years ago, we were able to provide them a place to play at Pierce College at the time. And then when our auditorium was being redesigned, we were able to play at Cal State Northridge. So we've had a great relationship. So the name of the piece is For Sir David, and it uses various motives from pieces that David Whitwell had written. So let's take a listen to that now. And Chuck Fernandez is going to be conducting the Los Angeles Symphonic Winds in For Sir David. Isn't that a terrific piece? And I thought Chuck did a great job of adding some great visuals to it, while the still pictures of David Whitwell, along with some of the books that he was written. He was quite a scholar on the history and development of the concert band. So that was just great. And this is only one of the contributions that the three people you're going to meet today have made. Chuck, you know, conducting. Geoff, of course, has soloed with me and also with Parker Games, did a great job. And Bob Crosby also appearing as the principal oboe player and also a member of the LA Winds jazz band. So we're looking forward to seeing all these three guys today. And together they have, I was figuring this out, over 50 years of experience in bringing the Los Angeles Symphonic Winds to the position of prominence that it holds today. So without further ado, I'm going to bring on in just a second my good friend Geoff Nudell, who has put together a phenomenal piece of music that he will tell us about in just a second. So if you'll please join me in welcoming my good friend and colleague, Geoff Nudell.
Hi, Steve. Hi.
Hey, Geoff, thank you so much for joining us today. And I want to talk to you a little bit. Well, we're going to actually in May, we're going to talk a little bit more about your career as a recording musician and the things that you've done along those lines. But I'm curious now, with all the things that have been going on in the past, I guess it's about a year, when so many venues have been closed down and so many opportunities for live performance are very limited or simply non-existent. What have you done musically to keep yourself functioning as an artistic musician?
Exactly. Well, not as much as before, but I've been managing to scare up some Dixieland gigs outdoors, cul-de-sacs, people's backyards, things like that, some weddings, And quite a number of recording sessions, which are not always outside, but follow COVID protocols very carefully. And in addition, private teaching is mostly nowadays relegated to primarily Zoom interaction online. But the thing that has kept me sane through this whole pandemic has actually been the thing that's been non-musical, is that I've been doing horticultural volunteer work with the Sky Valley Volunteers in our local mountains.
Excellent. That's really neat. Thanks. That one I didn't know about. I know about a lot of things, but that one I didn't know about.
Sure.
Thank you for sharing with us. Now, one thing I'm curious about, because it's something that I only pursued on the fringes, but people like you and Bob have really taken a deep dive in the concept of doubling, and
right,
that is playing more than one instrument. I struggle enough with the clarinet, for heaven's sake, and can barely get around on the saxophone. And when it came to flute, that didn't work at all. But you guys, on the other hand, have become very proficient at all these. What did you start with, and what was it that motivated you to take on these other challenges?
Well, I started actually on the piano. I think you know that. That was at age three. And when I was about 12 years old, I was a performer with the school orchestra, not a soloist, but a pianist playing either piano or synthesizer or some other auxiliary keyboard. But there were also several pianists at the time. And so we rotated. And so in maybe a 2.5 hour concert, I got to play one piece, maybe two if I was lucky. And I thought, and then I looked over at the band of musicians on stage there with the other horns and instruments and thinking, wow, they're playing all this music the whole time from start to finish. And I just rotate in on one piece. So I said, let's see what's on the shelf. So at that point, I picked up a clarinet and looked up a fingering guide in a Walter Piston book and got a hold of a reed and started to teach myself before I got some lessons in very short order, because I realized I was almost in over my head. But that's how it started, with the clarinet. And then I got a teacher, and my clarinet teacher, after advancing pretty quickly with him in a short order, said, you know, you'd probably make a good doubler. Of course, he was a doubler as well, this first teacher that I had. And you would think it would go right to the saxophone, but we skipped that for the moment, and I went right to the oboe, of all things. So I did that for a little while, but that didn't really stay indefinitely with me. But then the saxophone and the flute did. And so they became my mainstays.
Excellent. And thanks for sharing that with us. Now, you've selected a piece for us today that you're going to play, and just clarinet on this one.
Yes.
Like, it's really easy to just play the clarinet.
No.
But a fascinating piece that you chose. Can you tell us a little bit about the background before we hear it?
Sure. Okay. So, part of my reason for choosing this particular piece is my love of classic film score music, like Korngold and Bernard Herrmann. And this piece happens to be composed by David Raxon, who I'll talk about in just a little bit in a second. But it's with my connection to both David Raxon and the piece. It's the main theme. Actually, I will discuss it now. It'll be the easiest way to transition. The piece is from the main title of the movie, The Bad and the Beautiful, from 1953, with starring Kirk Douglas and Lana Turner. This is the main theme. David Raxon was friends with Mitchell Lurie, and Mitchell Lurie was a clarinet professor from USC and a studio clarinetist and a soloist as well, fairly renowned. And David Raxon wrote a version of this main theme for clarinet solo with piano accompaniment. It's a short version of it. And I happened to get a hold of it and thought, oh, I would love to do this. My connection with David Raxon is that I briefly studied film scoring many years back at the Dick Grove School of Music, and he was one of my instructors. And also back before the internet, there was snail mail and the telephone, and I was persistent, and I followed up with lessons with Mitchell Lurie, which he was reluctant to do because he was teaching at USC and I was a student at Cal State Northridge at the time. But he was willing, and I was forever grateful for that. And so that's the connection there. So the piece is The Bad and the Beautiful, the main theme for clarinet and piano.
Excellent. Let's take a listen to that now if we can.
Sure.
Well, that's just beautiful, Geoff. Thank you so much. And I hope you all enjoyed the visuals that I put with that, the great outtakes and the stills from the motion picture. And a couple of questions came in, which I think are kind of interesting. Somebody asked about whether Geoff is just a doubler or a tripler? Well, they call the phrase a doubler, but in Geoff's case, he's a great clarinet player, great saxophone player, great flute player, and he said the oboe career is behind him. He also played bassoon. I know he was roped into doing that in college as well. But so he does that. And then when we meet Bob Crosby in just a minute, he too does a lot of different instruments, clarinet, saxophone, flute, and he still plays oboe, unlike Geoff. Thanks so much, Geoff, for that contribution. So without further ado, let me bring on my good friend, Bob Crosby, and ask him to join us here on this live stream. Bob, welcome aboard.
Hi, Steve.
Hey, thank you so much for doing it. Somebody asked, I forgot to ask Geoff this, do you have a favorite instrument out of all of those that you play?
Oh, well, starting on clarinet, I have a fond love for the clarinet, but I enjoy playing all the other instruments, you know, depending on, you know, what the venue is. And it's offered me a chance to play a lot of different kind of music.
Excellent. Now, I know you started on clarinet, and we'll hear you at a young age playing clarinet in a little bit. But what prompted you to pursue the other instruments as well? As I mentioned before, I had a tough enough time on clarinet that I wasn't about to try to do too much else besides saxophone and bad flute playing. What encouraged you to keep going and learn all the other instruments that you can play?
Well, when I was with that Dixieland band that we're going to see and talk about a little bit later, after that was going for a couple of years, they thought it would be a good idea if I played saxophone so that they could work in some saxophone numbers. So they actually encouraged that. And then sometime later, I was taking lessons from Ben Canner, who I understand you took lessons from as well. And he was a very great doubler in the studios. And he got me going on flute. And I kind of stayed with those instruments through, you know, most of my early adulthood. And sometime in my 30s, I decided to take up the oboe because it gave me the opportunity to do Broadway shows where they throw in the oboe into a lot of the saxophone parts. So kind of later in life, I took up the oboe.
Excellent. Now, I'm curious about one thing. You know, music schools and conservatories offer music education, obviously, lessons on instruments, but there's always the concern about what the stuff you learn in school, is that really what you need to know in the real world? So I'm curious to find out from you how you would compare the education, the formal education you got in school, as opposed to the school of hard knocks, the real world school.
Well, I had some good teachers in college, and I had the opportunity to play in some good musical groups, but nothing beats, I mean, I could have foregone all of that and just have, you know, playing in jobs, you know, actually being under the gun and having to reach a certain level of proficiency with really good players next to you. They kind of bring you up to that level. And so I think that was the best education, just really playing with great people.
Yeah, I agree. I had a good education as well, but when you start to get out in the real world and you really have to do it, that really elevates your game quite a bit. I know what you mean. Now, we're going to go back in time, I think, to the year is 1957, if I'm not mistaken. And we're going to hear you performing with a group called the Dixieland Small Fry. And I think we have a couple of still pictures of you performing with that group. Maybe you can comment about this a little bit.
Yeah, and tell us what we're real quickly, a man named Bill Hollingsworth, who was in local television. He was Captain Jet on KTLA Channel 5. He was a trumpet player. He'd played in the Air Force Band. And he got together. He went around and auditioned young kids. And he auditioned me when I was 10 years old. He came to the music studio that I was taking lessons from. And I got in the band. And we started doing local shows. We did a show called Panorama Pacific, which was for some of your viewers who are of a certain age and local Los Angelinos. That was a morning show. And because of his connections, we did quite a few shows, Tennessee Ernie Ford Show, Danny Thomas Show, the Lawrence Welk Show. And eventually, well, we did a record album, which I think you have a picture of. And eventually we had our own show on KTLA. It was a weekly show. It was on Sunday evenings at 6 o'clock. It came after Polka Parade, Dick Sinclair's Polka Parade, another local show. There were a lot of local shows in those days, not so much anymore. And then we did a few national shows. We did, Ray Bolger did a special in New York. They flew us out there. And Benny Goodman was also a guest on that show, and I got to meet him, and it was a great thrill for an 11-year-old. And he even signed a reed for me. And then we did this Dinah Shore Chevy show, this big Sunday night Chevy show that she had for many years. And I believe we have a clip from that.
Yeah, let's, there's the album cover.
There's the album with Liberty Records. And it was the only album we did. I understand that Joel Kabeloff, one of our players, actually found that album in a thrift shop sometime. And it was kind of interesting. He told me that.
Excellent. Well, look, let's, I have a couple more questions I want to ask you, but let's take a look at this clip from the Dinah Shore show. And there's a special guest on that show that we haven't talked about yet, but we can talk about him a little bit on the other side. So here we go. This is Dinah Shore show, 1957.
I want you to go blow the dust off your saxophone, honey, because you're about to meet the swinginest little two-beat outfit this side of New Orleans. The Dixie Small Fry. There they are.
I'm one of the old men in the outfield. I'm Geoff Woodruff.
Oh, you are? But how old are you, Geoff?
14.
Oh, yeah, you're getting on. That's true. Now, how about you?
I'm Jay DeVerson. I'm 13 years old.
13 years old. Well, you're traveling on to... Wow. And how about you, honey?
My name's Bob Crosby. I'm 11.
Your name's what?
Bob Crosby. No relation.
Oh, I see. You're playing Dixieland, though.
Yep.
Yeah, where the Bobcats? And what's your name?
My name's Frank Street.
Well, the only thing I know by heart is the Whip and Poop song. Could you play a few bars with Whip and Poop?
Okay, folks. One, two, two, two.
Well, that's great. Chuck, I just got one, Bob, I just have one more question to ask you. before we bring on Chuck, and that is, you talked about studying with Ben Cantor and some of the other things you did as a child player, but as a professional player, what are some of the groups that you played with that provided you with some of your most satisfying moments as a musician?
Well, I was with the Stan Kenton Orchestra for a couple of years.
Wow.
And that was a thrill. I actually got to meet Duke Ellington and shake hands with him, one of the clubs we played at. And I was in a pop rock group called Seals and Crofts that had quite a few hit records. I had a little clarinet solo on one of their pieces called I'll Play for You. And Shindig, an old Shindig TV show. Jimmy O'Neill, I don't know if anybody remembers that, but it was a big show, and it got so popular they sent out a road tour, and I went out on that when I was 18 years old. I was right out of high school.
Excellent. Well, thank you so much, Bob, for sharing, and some great playing, particularly for an 11-year-old kid. I was pretty impressed with that, and I noticed you didn't have any music in front of you either. I think that's called improvising, if I'm not mistaken.
Yeah, thank you.
Excellent. Great job, Bob. Thank you so much. And now I'd like to bring on the third guest that we have today, and like me, he is not quite as versatile from the standpoint of playing other woodwind instruments as the previous guests that we've had, but that's okay. He can play bassoon, which is puts him in a special category. And if I remember correctly, when we were down in New Orleans performing with the Los Angeles Symphonic Winds, he confessed to also being a rock and roll saxophone player. So would you please join me in welcoming my good friend, Chuck Fernandez.
Hey, it's great to be here. And I loved seeing that clip of Bob. That was great.
Isn't that great? Some really terrific playing and some great commentary too. And to see Fred McMurray picking up his saxophone. Oh my gosh, that was just great. So listen, I have a couple of questions for you because I'm curious about your involvement in something that perhaps you weren't especially interested in as recently as 5 or 10 years ago. And that is a group called the Song of Angels Flute Orchestra, or flute ensembles in particular. How is it that you came to be involved with flute ensembles?
Well, a lot of things seem to head back to the LA Winds, I have to say. There are several flautists in the group who were part of this group called the Song of the Angels Flute Orchestra, and I had actually conducted them for a Christmas program, conducted some of the players on an LA Winds program for the holidays, and they asked if I would come out and maybe try conducting the group, and they liked what I did. And so that was over 6 years ago now. Hard to believe how the time flies, but I've been conducting them for about 6 years or a little over.
Now, listen, as a composer and arranger, have you had the opportunity to put your skills in those fields to work with the Song of Angels Flute Orchestra?
Well, as any composer can tell you, you're going to write for what's available to you. And so I actually started writing for that group, and I've written several works for them and a bunch of arrangements as well. As a matter of fact, in 2016, I was commissioned by a good friend, Francine Pencost, to write something for her publishing company. And it was called A Quiet House and a Mouse. And she put it, without me knowing it, she put it in to the National Flute Association competition for large flute ensemble stuff, and it won. So I must have been doing something right. And I've written a bunch of stuff for them since then. And you're right that I'm a bass clef player. I'm used to seeing, you know, to hearing a lot of rich notes, but we're very, very fortunate. And you'll see in the video, look along the back wall. They have got some really rare instruments along the back. Double contra in F. Contra bass flutes and the bass in F. And the problem is when you get these big flutes, they're wonderful, but they don't make a lot of sound. So you need a bunch of them to really get the bass going, but they do it wonderfully.
Excellent. Well, now, with this kind of ensemble, which many people may not be familiar with, although our LA Winds family have heard the group on a number of different occasions and they've really enjoyed it, But where do you guys play? Have you done, I know you do things locally, but beyond things in Southern California, what else have the Song of Angels Flute Orchestra participated in?
Well, we have done a lot of concerts here in the LA area. We've done it with La Crescenta, we've done Santa Monica, we've actually done a few concerts in down near Encinitas, near San Diego. We would go down there, we've gone down there three or four times. We went to Salt Lake City a few years ago for the flute conference there, and we were set to go to Japan until the pandemic brought all that to a screeching halt. But we're hopefully going to do that in a couple of years when it gets back up and running. That's where we've played. We've played a lot, though.
Excellent, excellent. Now, the piece that we're going to hear features a terrific guitar player by the name of Massimo Sammi, if I'm not mistaken. Mm-hmm. And I just want to know how it is that this piece came about. And can you tell us a little bit about the piece in general, the genesis of it, and how it came to be and how it came to be recorded before we play it for our listeners?
Well, Massimo is a wonderful composer and a wonderful jazz guitarist. And the first I heard of this piece was he had won a competition with ASMAC, which is the American Society of Music Arrangers and Composers. He won with this arrangement, but for the original ensemble of string orchestra. And so I heard the piece, and then he studied with me at UCLA Extension, and I told him, dude, you've got to do a flute orchestra version of this, which is how this came about. Now, once every year, when we were doing concerts, and we will again, we would always do a concert in June called Jazzy Flutes, and we would bring in a rhythm section to play with us, and then we'd have a series of soloists. And so that's what this was a part of. And I'd like to invite anybody who wants to, please, you know, go to soaflutorchestra.com. You can hear tons of videos. But anyway, so we did this with him, and he has done other arrangements with us, and I have him working on yet another one now because he has such a soul to his writing. It's really, really wonderful stuff.
Excellent. Well, we're looking forward to hearing it. The piece is entitled Tenderly. It features Massimo Sammi as the guitar soloist and the Song of Angels Flute Orchestra as directed by Charles Fernandez. Thank you. Well, thank you, Chuck, for sharing that with us today. And also thank you to our many listeners out there who sent in some wonderful comments while this live stream was taking place. Thank you for those comments. It really helps us to move along and perhaps improve some of the things that we've been doing. We really appreciate that. Now, before we bring the performers on one more time to wave goodbye to everybody, I would like to tell you a little bit about the show that we're doing 2 weeks from now, and that's going to be on St. Patrick's Day, as a matter of fact. So we've got a special program lined up for you. It's called, what did I title? The Wearing of the Green and Other Blarney Stones. There it is, you see, scrolling across the bottom of your screen. And we'll feature a beautiful arrangement of that Irish air entitled Be Thou Mine Vision that will open up the program with the LA Winds performing from a live concert a couple of years ago. And then we'll bring back our Irish music specialist, Sue Winsberg, to perform and tell you a little bit about the Irish culture and history. And then we'll switch countries and Andrea Vancouver will join us to talk a little bit about her heritage. And then Ruth Beaver, one of our bassoonists, will be performing a beautiful selection, which in the titles to these things makes reference to various precious stones. It's really an interesting work. I think you'll enjoy it. And then we'll close out the session in 2 weeks on St. Patrick's Day with a beautiful rendition of Irish tune from County Derry, which many of us know as Danny Boy, with the United States Marine Corps band playing it in a Zoom production in which one of our alums and a former student of Geoff Nudell, Parker Games, is featured in that with the Marine Corps band. It should be quite a show. So if I can ask my distinguished colleagues, Geoff Nudell, Bob Crosby, and Chuck Fernandez to join us, we'll say goodbye to you and thank you for your kind attention. See you in 2 weeks and St. Patrick's Day. Take care, everybody. Be safe.